This time we're bringing you deep into the eastern German uplands, near the place where we grew up. At the end of winter, we spent 2 days in the Ore Mountains to search for abandonments. This was turning out really simple because this region has an extreme density of derelict sites. As guerrilla preservationists of such buildings, we try to document the stories hidden behind forgotten walls. In our two-part series, we lead you through a range of places rich in variety. From a perfectly preserved time capsule to dangerously unstable structures reclaimed by nature. Join us, Marco, Till, and Cornelius on day one of our newest adventure. Clean mountain air, no noise, and rural idle. Here our adventure started. This village is a paradise for those who seek rest and relaxation, or for those who seek derelict witnesses of the past. Over the scattered cabins in the valley, the landmark of the community sits enthroned. As many other buildings here, this one as well is abandoned and forgotten. And yet this former hunting chateau has a meaningful story, because actually a royal family was living here at one time. Reason enough for a short exploration. While in the rest of Germany already temperatures of 15 degrees Celsius and above prevailed, there were still piles of snow here. After more than 15 years of vacancy, the old manor unfortunately isn't offering much anymore today. Even door was let off steam here already. All that remains is the great architecture and the moving history. And of course the decay we love so much. The impressive building was constructed in the 1870s and was used as a hunting residence of the Saxon nobles in the 20th century. In fact, the stately home was in possession of the royal family, which was also spending a lot of time here. Those two postcards date back to around the year 1900, by the way. It was a very breezy day, and when wind is whistling through derelict structures, sometimes weird sounds originate. Better turn on English subtitles now, if you don't understand any German.
Hier ist jemand. Hört ihr das nicht? Oh, das ist der Wind, der Kinderstimmen nachmacht.
Ja, ich denke das.
Alter, was? Was?
As a matter of fact, there were very strange sounds, but we were sure that we were the only people in the building. But as it turned out, we weren't. We shared the hunting lodge with four photographers, some kind of urbex family. So we didn't imagine a child's voice, because there was actually a little boy. One member of the group was kind enough to show us around and tell the history of the site. After the end of monarchy in 1918, the manor house was becoming less important. Now it was transformed into a hotel owned by a Masonic lodge. But when the lodge was banned by the Nazi regime soon afterwards, it was only allowed for soldiers to take a vacation here. During the war, the German Wehrmacht used the building as a sick bay for wounded of the Russian campaign. Later, Soviet occupying forces were dispossessing the owner, and the place was used as another vacation home. We found a postcard that can give you a good impression of that time. After the political wind of change in Germany of 1990, the estate was used as a training and conference center of the region's police school. Then, only the noble architecture was a reminiscence of the original role of the building. But still today, you can find some debris of the time of the police school.
Wir haben hier anscheinend einen Telefonraum gefunden.
Eine Telefonzelle, eine richtige.
Früher gab es anscheinend nur das eine Telefon hier. Und hier schön in die Tür selber professorisch reingeschnitten. Und dann das Glas einfach eingesetzt.
Around the year 2000, the building was abandoned, and since then, it's without any hope of new use. The hunting lodge is listed as a cultural relic, but this means nothing because it was left to rot anyways. At least birds found a way to profit from the old walls. We, however, were now looking where we could start our next travel back in time. And actually, we spotted an interesting looking inn not that far away. More precisely, it was right next door. Just look how close it is to the manor. It's perfect when we have such short ways. A last look at the imposing exterior of the historical building. And then we dedicated ourselves to the hotel down in the valley. As it seemed, the Urbex family had the same destination. However, they were walking on the street, which was actually quite a long way. We, on the other hand, were taking the shortcut down the slope. By the way, this valley is the coldest one in the whole mountain region. But we didn't know that when we came here, and that's why we didn't expect to find so much snow here. Especially not snow that deep. However, we immediately spotted an open window when approaching from the backside. To be honest, there were more easy ways to get in the building complex as taking the path over the porch roof. Anyways, now we were here. So let's get in there. We wouldn't have thought to find something like this in here. This room was still fully furnished. And apparently, this was no exception. We were welcomed by the boy of the Urbex family, and he told us that everything was simply left behind. So we took a short break before we started to explore the old inn very closely. During our research, we couldn't find out much about the premises. But the fact is that you would never believe this building complex is really abandoned when you see the interior. To some extent, rooms are still dust-free, so the inn can only be vacant for a short period of time. We were even able to replicate a shot from an old postcard. Not that much has changed from back then till today. In the main building, we found hotel rooms on several floors. At the end, the compound was used as a boarding house and a tavern. A variety of guests could be accommodated here. Especially in winter, the valley is in great demand. Plenty of tourists are coming here for winter sports in the mountains. In order to differentiate from the high amount of other lodgings in close proximity, the operator wanted to make the experience for the visitors as pleasant as possible. That's why there was even a little spa area here with a sauna. And some smaller pools. We now leave you with some impressions of the old inn, just so that you can get an idea of how life must have been here in the past. Meanwhile, we reached the old restaurant. Once this must have been the busiest area of the house. Today, yawning emptiness and total silence dominate. We had a good look around here as well. It basically felt like being in a fully working restaurant that had just another rest day. Despite raids by thieves and criminals on a regular basis, there was the bigger part of the original equipment still in place. There were only a few indicators that time was standing still here. But you can see the preceding decay most clearly when you look on the ground. Some kind of fungus was spreading and growing between those rotten planks. From the refectory, we were heading to the kitchen. You can also see clear signs of scavenging here. We wondered how bad the condition of the building must have been if we had explored the site only a few weeks after. Unfortunately, we don't know when the inn was constructed, but it's probably one of the oldest buildings in the whole village. Till today, not that much has changed. Only a connecting structure between main building and restaurant was added. During the time of the German Democratic Republic, this was a popular recreation home. After the reunification of Germany, still many tourists were checking in. But eventually, the numbers of guests decreased. That's also the reason why so many other places in the community are vacant today. Restoration works that the owner started show that he had hope for an improvement of the situation until the bitter end. But probably money ran out at some point and the hotel had to close down for good. If only the neighboring hunting chateau had been a touristic attraction, the whole story of the building complex would have probably turned out completely different. Or what do you think? We left the cold valley behind us. It wasn't that late, but actually the sun was supposed to set soon. But we had one more destination, which was around 15 kilometers of linear distance from those two buildings we have already shown you. This is a place of cult for the community, called Biosphere. However, during the last years, it has become noticeably quiet around the old country hostel, and barely any photos get published nowadays. As far as we know, the premises are the complete opposite to the well-preserved inn we just showed you. You will see in a bit what we mean by that. But at first, we had to hope that there was still a possibility to access the ramshackle hut. Okay, this was way easier than we thought it would be. The most important thing was now to buckle up the safety gear. Respiratory masks and gloves are essential because mildew and decay are hazardous to health here. You can see now why we wanted to experience the place so badly, despite the risks. This place is simply impressive. Some of the rooms are resembling a botanical garden. The reason of the structure's low decomposition is moisture that's soaking in easily everywhere through the rotten roof. So this scenery was created after several decades of vacancy. Dolls, stuffed animals, and those small vanity basins are reminding of the building's last function. Once this used to be a country hostel for children, for the whole federal state and beyond that. In this annex, pupils were accommodated in the past. Here we also discovered photos and scrapped articles from the time when the hostel was still active. We were now switching to the main building. This two-storied villa used to be a steam-driven dairy factory. From raw milk, butter and cheese, as you know it, were produced. But in order to do this, a system was used that was powered by a steam engine. These kinds of creameries have sprung in the 1890s. Around the time of World War II, business was closed because these factories had to give place to modern technologies. After the war, the building was extended by the wing we were exploring in the beginning. Now it has turned into a company vacation home for, attention, fun fact, the first abandoned place we've ever explored as BWT. In our former hometown, there used to be a plant for producing and distributing synthetic leather. It was exported to distant lands and had employees from all around the world. Due to the size, it was necessary to find a place where staff can spend their holidays. And this place was 60 kilometers away in the Ore Mountains. The mural in the old dining room dates back to that time. Here you can see how dangerous the place had become by now. Just before last winter, major parts of the intermediate ceiling collapsed. Earlier in the dining hall, there was the most popular photo subject. But today, it better shouldn't be entered anymore. This might explain why there's barely any content of this abandonment posted online at the moment. These images are already over 1 year old and were taken by two photographers from Belgium we accidentally met during one of our explorations. For more fascinating photos of abandoned Europe, take a look on their social media page, Schiffer Photography, which you can find a link to in the video description down below. And then we also went upstairs, to where the ceiling collapsed. We didn't dare to move further, and here we ended our exploration, because we already had seen everything that was left behind of the structure. After the political turnaround at the end of the Cold War, this compound was privatized. The vacation home for workers was turned into a country hostel for students. However, it was never maintained. And since it was only used during vacation periods, the condition went from bad to worse in no time. When exactly it was abandoned, we can't say, but probably before the turn of the millennium. And so, we reached the end of our first day in the Ore Mountains. It was a day full of exciting and diverse explorations. But before we could continue, we caught the attention of the village youth. After that, we headed out to find a place for wild camping. We were saving the best abandoned spot for day two. So stay tuned to see what we have in stock for you in our upcoming episode. Next time on Broken Window Theory. We were striking our tent quite early, because we had an exciting mission. In another valley, somewhere in the Ore Mountains, there's the skeleton of a once big factory. But actually, we weren't interested in those old halls. It was this old school that was drawing us to it. A mix of decay and left behind items made us spend hours in here. And if you're a fan of more pristine abandonments, we have something interesting for you as well. Because right next to the Strawberry School, there's an old arts and leisure center. And here we made a rather untypical discovery. How did you like today's episode? Let us know in the comments which one of those three abandoned sites you have enjoyed the most. If you want to help us improve our content even more, feel free to support us on Patreon. Only $1 per month already makes a difference. Thanks for your patronage and keep exploring.